In 1944, during World War II, two planes crash-land on a remote South Pacific island, and their pilots, American soldier Hank Marlowe and Japanese soldier Gunpei Ikari, find themselves locked in a fierce and deadly battle. The confrontation leads them from the beach into the dense jungle. Hank is cornered at the edge of a cliff, but before Gunpei can deliver a final blow with his knife, a giant gorilla's hand emerges from the cliff's edge, revealing the presence of a massive creature. 1973. In Washington, two men, Bill Randa, head of the U.S. government organization Monarch, and Dr. Houston Brooks, a geologist, arrive at the White House to meet with Senator Willis. They seek his support for an expedition to an uncharted island in the South Pacific called Skull Island, famous for its legends and mysterious disappearances of ships and planes. Randa believes that the 1954 nuclear tests were not tests at all but attempts to destroy something on the island. He is convinced that the island holds an unimaginable ecosystem worth exploring. While the senator is initially skeptical, Randa and Brooks persuade him to grant them permission, as there is an upcoming mission nearby that they can join, and they don't want the Russians to get there first. The senator agrees to help, but he emphasizes that this will be the last favor he grants them. Randa also insists on a military escort for the expedition. Next, we are shown an American airbase in Vietnam, where soldiers are preparing to return home as the war comes to an end. Among them are officers Glenn Mills, Earl Cole, Reg Slivko, Rills, and their lieutenant colonel, Preston Packard. After enjoying some drinks, Packard returns to his office, where Major Jack Chapman checks on him. Chapman already has a future job lined up, but Packard feels that his accomplishments have been in vain. Later, at night, Packard receives a call inviting him to join Randa's mission, and he eagerly accepts. In Saigon, Brooks and Randa head to a bar to recruit a former Special Air Service captain as their tracker. They find James Conrad, playing pool and winning money. When his opponents try to harm him after losing, Conrad defends himself skillfully with the cue stick. They all sit down to negotiate the deal. Conrad requests 5 times the offered money and a bonus for returning safely due to the expedition's extreme danger. They agree, and although Conrad wants to know the exact purpose of the mission, Brooks and Randa only reveal that they need his expertise in exploring perilous territory. Meanwhile, photojournalist Mason Weaver receives news that she's been accepted into Randa's expedition, which excites her. She explains that different sources have given her conflicting information, suggesting that something secretive is happening. A few days later in Bangkok, all the characters assemble to board the boat. The soldiers are displeased with the new mission as they had eagerly anticipated returning home after the war. Weaver introduces herself to Steve Woodward, a NASA employee, and then to Packard, who disapproves of her anti-war journalism. The ship sets sail, and the explorers gather for a talk by another NASA official, Victor Nieves. He explains that the island is hidden by a perpetual storm system, but they plan to navigate through it with Packard's military helicopters. Brooks and Randa are introduced, along with the third scientist, San Lin. Brooks explains their plan to use explosives for mapping the island, and Chapman warns them about the storm's interference with radio contact. After the meeting, Conrad and Weaver explore the boat and share their suspicions about the true purpose of the expedition. Shortly afterward, they reach the island's location, and the storm appears even more menacing in person. Randa wants to cross it, but Nieves disagrees. The decision to proceed is left to Packard, who decides to move forward. The soldiers and civilian teams board a fleet of helicopters and take off smoothly at first. However, things get complicated as they enter the storm, dodging constant lightning and enduring continuous shaking. Packard, with his experience, manages to keep his cool and guides the fleet through with an analogy of Icarus until they safely make it through. The island they reach is breathtaking, but there is little time to enjoy it as the plan begins. All civilians, except Weaver, Randa, and Conrad, are left on land while the helicopters spread out to find the designated bomb-dropping spots. The radar quickly confirms Brooks' theory, as the bedrock is discovered to be hollow. Everything seems to be going well until disaster strikes. One helicopter is struck and knocked down by a flying tree, while another is grabbed by a giant hand and crushed. The soldiers witness the imposing figure of Kong, the giant gorilla, roaring at them from the horizon. Kong defends himself against the soldiers' gunfire as the bullets fail to harm him. He effortlessly moves among the helicopters, knocking them down one by one and smashing some soldiers who manage to land safely. Eventually, all the choppers are destroyed, and Kong departs only when none remain in the air. The attack scatters all the members of the expedition. Weaver, Nieves, Slivko, Brooks, San Lin, and Conrad find themselves together and head north to reach the meeting point. Meanwhile, Chapman is alone but manages to convey his position to Packard before communication goes dark. Packard and Rells are together in another location, and they soon meet up with Cole, Mills, Woodward, and a couple more soldiers. They discover that Randa is also nearby, so Packard speaks to him privately. Packard aims his gun at Randa and demands the truth behind the expedition. Randa reveals that monsters exist, and the bombs were not dropped for geology but to lure something out. Years ago, Randa survived a monster attack on a ship, but the government covered it up, and his family was told the ship sank in battle. Randa's determination to protect humanity from these creatures has never wavered, and he wants to bring proof home to rally support. Packard declares that he is the one to take action, likening himself to the cavalry. Meanwhile, Conrad's group faces communication issues and encounters a massive bison-like creature near a lake. Slivko prepares to shoot the creature, but Conrad stops him since it poses no threat. The creature observes them briefly before leaving peacefully. On the other side, Packard and his soldiers search for Chapman and the special weapons. As they traverse the jungle, one of their soldiers is killed by a giant spider's leg impaling his throat. They realize they are facing a gigantic spider and start firing at it. Unfortunately, Mills is caught in the spider's limbs, obstructing their ability to shoot. The team focuses on cutting the spider's legs to free Mills, who also uses a knife to aid in his escape. After a challenging struggle, they manage to defeat the spider. Meanwhile, Conrad's team stumbles upon abandoned ruins and is immediately confronted by natives aiming their weapons at them. The tension eases when Hank, a pilot from World War II who landed here, appears among the natives and assures them everything is fine. Hank guides the team into the ruins, and they proceed cautiously. Chapman, on the other hand, hides behind a rock as he observes Kong arriving at the scene. He witnesses the mighty ape drinking water and suddenly grabbing a giant octopus from the river. The octopus attempts to attack Kong with its tentacles, but Kong swiftly defeats it, tearing off its limbs and devouring them. Kong leaves, dragging the rest of the octopus with him. In the village, Hank explains that they will be safe as long as they stay with the natives, who are protected by a massive wall built not to keep Kong out, but to shield them from other monsters. Hank takes them to an old shipwreck and reveals ancient paintings on the rocks. These paintings depict the natives' historical beliefs. For thousands of years, they lived in fear of the monsters until some of these creatures started to protect them instead. In this place, Kong is highly revered as the king and a god to the inhabitants. He refrains from attacking unless provoked. Guinpei's death, however, was not caused by Kong but by another creature called the Skullcrawlers. These large lizards dwell underground and were awakened by the bombing. Usually, Kong can handle them, but the largest one, responsible for killing Kong's family, poses a serious threat. Conrad changes the topic, discussing the rescue team that is expected to arrive in 3 days. Hank doubts they can reach the north end of the island on foot in such a short time. Meanwhile, Packard's team is traversing a swamp and encounters a group of peculiar birds. Though the birds don't attack, Packard shoots one, causing the others to flee. The soldiers grow anxious, but Cole urges them to trust Packard. Back with Conrad and the group, Hank reveals that he and Guinpei had begun building a boat before Guinpei's death. Now, the team will help Hank complete the boat to reach the rescue team in time. While they work on the repairs, Weaver engages with the island's natives, capturing photographs of them. During her exploration, she hears a noise from the other side of a wall and investigates to find one of the bison-like creatures trapped under a plane. Struggling to move the plane alone, she attempts to help but lacks the strength. To her relief, Kong arrives and lifts the plane himself. He gazes at her briefly before departing, seemingly approving of her actions. As Packard's team searches for Chapman, they discover Kong's bloodstain on a mountain, realizing the creature can be harmed and even killed. Meanwhile, Conrad's team continues working on the boat as Chapman tries to communicate via radio, but without success. Sitting on a large trunk for a break, Chapman realizes it's not a fallen tree but a creature that resembles one. He shoots it, scaring it away, but attracting the attention of another monster. Before he can react, a Skullcrawler devours him. Night falls, and in the village, Conrad and Weaver watch the northern lights. Weaver attempts to take a picture, but her flashlight is broken. Conrad lends her his lighter, a precious gift from his heroic father who fought in World War II. In the jungle, Packard's team sets up camp, and Rand expresses doubt about the plan's wisdom. Packard retorts that if Rand dislikes his leadership, he can leave. The following morning, the boat is prepared for departure. Hank takes the sword from Guinpei's grave, treasuring it as Guinpei became like a brother during their time together. Everyone boards the boat, and after some extra effort, they finally set sail. As Hank shares his story about the family he left behind, they receive a call from Packard's team. The team asks them to shoot a signal to reveal their location, and Packard complies. Thankfully, Packard's team is nearby and able to pick them up. However, their joy is short-lived as a peculiar bird swoops down and takes Nieves away to its flock for a meal. With limited options, they decide to keep moving. After a couple of hours, they reach the boat and reunite with Packard and his team. Conrad suggests they quickly board the ship and leave, but Packard is determined to find Chapman. Despite Hank's objections, Packard insists on going west, where the dangerous skullcrawlers reside. Reluctantly, Conrad agrees, but only if they return by nightfall. They embark on their search for Chapman and come across the skeletal remains of Kong's parents. Hank expresses his concerns, but Packard orders them to pass through the mass grave, which is veiled in a peculiar mist. They soon discover that the mist is flammable when Cole accidentally drops his cigarette, causing an unexpected explosion. They make only limited progress before encountering a skullcrawler, prompting them to seek refuge behind enormous bones. The skullcrawler regurgitates a skull, which Conrad notices bears Chapman's name tag. It appears to leave, and the team cautiously emerges. However, when Randa's camera flash goes off, the skullcrawler attacks, devouring him. The team opens fire, but the lizard conceals itself in the mist, making it difficult to target. Suddenly, it emerges in front of Hank, who manages to strike it with a sword before being knocked aside. The skullcrawler devours one of the soldiers and then targets Weaver. A soldier retaliates with a flamethrower, but the skullcrawler uses its tail to launch the soldier, causing an explosion. Slivko was injured and knocked out by the blast, landing near gas cans. Meanwhile, the peculiar birds return, and Conrad dons a gas mask and Hank's sword to enter the gas-filled area. He fends off the birds along the way and reaches Slivko. Unfortunately, the skullcrawler also reaches them. Fortunately, Weaver intervenes just in time, throwing Conrad's lighter at the monster, causing a massive explosion. After leaving the mass grave, Hank expresses to Packard how terrible an idea it is to proceed with their plan. Conrad informs everyone that Chapman has died, proving it with the creature's name tag that it had regurgitated. Despite the evidence, Packard remains fixated on reaching the crash site to retrieve explosives for killing Kong. Hank, Conrad, the scientists, and Weaver attempt to dissuade him, explaining that Kong is not a threat and had acted in self-defense. However, Packard remains adamant. Tensions rise, and everyone draws their weapons, suggesting a confrontation is imminent. Conrad steps in and offers a compromise. He will reveal the crash site's location to Packard and his soldiers, but he will take the civilians back to the boat. Woodward chooses to go with the soldiers. On the way, they come across Chapman's belongings and collect them to send back to his family. Meanwhile, Conrad and Weaver search for higher ground to get a better view of the river and the boat's possible location. They reach the edge of a cliff and witness Kong's visit. Surprisingly, Kong doesn't attack because he recognizes Weaver, who bravely touches his nose. However, Kong is disturbed by the explosions set off by the soldiers' trap, prompting him to roar and depart the scene. Conrad and Weaver reunite with their team and instruct them to head back to the boat. However, Hank decides to join them upon learning of their plan to rescue Kong. Meanwhile, Kong reaches the soldiers, prepared for a fight. Packard throws a torch, encircling Kong with a ring of fire. Kong appears to be in agony, but he pushes through the flames, striking Woodward and collapsing to the ground. Packard urges his soldiers to set their charges, but their hesitation is evident after witnessing Kong's suffering. As they reach for the detonators, Conrad, Weaver, and Hank arrive to intervene. Tensions rise as soldiers and civilians point their weapons at each other, but Slivko stands against Packard. Conrad calls for an end to the conflict, but suddenly, a noise emerges from the water. It's the largest skullcrawler. Amidst chaos, the group flees, leaving Packard behind, determined to use the detonator to kill Kong. Instead, Kong wakes up and crushes Packard, dealing with the skullcrawler in a fierce battle but getting overpowered. As the sun rises, the group reaches the island's edge. Weaver fires a flare for Brooks to see while they create a diversion to buy some time. Conrad and the soldiers run, with Cole opting to stay behind and sacrifice himself. He intends to detonate his explosives when the skullcrawler approaches, but the lizard's tail knocks him away. The skullcrawler is on the verge of attacking the rest of the team when Kong suddenly reappears. He fiercely punches and smashes the lizard multiple times, while Weaver climbs to a higher position and shoots a flare. Despite a few more hits, including one with a tree, Kong is pushed back by the skullcrawler and accidentally falls onto some chains that had restrained him. As the lizard is about to deliver a fatal blow to Kong, the scientists arrive on a boat, shooting at the Skullcrawler with their weapons as the soldiers climb aboard. With Weaver's well-aimed flare shot at its neck, they successfully distract the monster long enough for Kong to free himself from the chains and use one as a weapon against the Skullcrawler. He strikes the Skullcrawler with the chain before grabbing it and forcefully slamming it against the mountain. The impact causes Weaver to fall into the water, and Kong quickly notices her, rushing to knock out the Skullcrawler before extending his hand to rescue her from the water. He pulls her out just as the Skullcrawler attempts to make a comeback, leaping on Kong and latching onto his wrist with its tongue. Kong takes advantage of this, grabbing the Skullcrawler's tongue and ultimately killing it by tearing its guts out. After dealing with the threat, Kong ensures Weaver's safety, gently setting her down on the ground. Conrad comes to check on her, and together they watch as Kong gives them one last look before departing. Soon after, the entire team is back on the boat, heading to the designated meeting point. They express concern that the place might change due to the events, but they make a promise not to disclose anything about the encounter. As a fleet of helicopters arrives for their rescue, Kong appears one last time, roaring for the camera. Afterward, two final bonus scenes unfold. In one scene, Hank reunites with his wife and son, finally safe and together. The other scene features Conrad and Weaver, who believe they've been captured by the military. However, they are met by Brooks and San Lin, who explain that they have discovered footage of a cave revealing other monster kings like Kong. The cave drawings represent legendary creatures, including Godzilla, Mothra, Rodan, and King Ghidorah. The closing image captures a fierce battle between Godzilla and Ghidorah, setting the stage for further epic encounters.